Good evening. It's a pleasure and an honor to be here. And I want to thank the Sheldon Chimera Foundation and the Rona Amir Foundation for inviting me to speak. I'm here because four people who should be here are not here. Zeynep, Sahar, Kiti, and Rona. They're not here because they were murdered on June 30th, 2009. When their killers were sentenced, no one stood in court to give victim impact statements. No one put into words the horrible sadness of those deaths. I wrote Without Honor in part to give Zeynep, Sahar, Kiti, and Rona a voice. You honor their memories by being here tonight, and I thank you. I was the senior crime reporter at the Kingston Wake Standard on that day 4 years ago. I was the first journalist to arrive at the Kingston Mills locks, which are part of the Rideau Canal system in Kingston, when a small black car was found underwater. Inside, Zeynep, Sahar, Kiti, and Rona. I followed the story of the covert police investigation, the arrests of Mohammed Shafi, Tuba Yahya, and Ahmed Shafi, and the arduous 30-month court process that unfolded until the three were each convicted of four counts of first-degree murder. That entire saga lasted roughly 3.5 years. I was there in court every day during the preliminary inquiry, the many days of pre-trial proceedings, and the three-month-long trial. I interviewed dozens of people who knew Zeynep, Sahar, Kiti, and Rona, friends, relatives, people who loved them. I came to one inescapable conclusion. The singular fact about this story that I think is most disturbing, they should not have died. We should have saved them. How could we not have saved them? And when I say we, I mean all of us, everyone in this room, and beyond. How did a society that cherishes freedom, choice, independence, and enshrines those concepts in the Charter of Rights and Freedoms, how did this society allow them to die? There were so many warnings, so many cries for help, and so many signs of danger. On May 7th, 2008, that's 14 months before the murders, Sahar told a teacher at her high school that she wanted to kill herself because life at home was unbearable. Later that day, she told a child protection worker that she was being psychologically and physically abused at home. On April 17th, 2009, 10 weeks before the murders, four Shafi children, including Kiti and Sahar, told a police officer that they'd been physically abused by their father and older brother a week before and threatened with death. One of the girls had a bruise near her eye. On June 5th, roughly 3 weeks before the murders, Sahar told a high school teacher that she feared being beaten by her father, who was soon returning to Canada from an overseas business trip. 3 days later, on June the 8th, Sahar told a social worker that she wanted to get a job and earn money so that she could move away from home as soon as she turned 18. 12 days later, someone conducted a Google search on a computer in the Shafi home. Person typed where to commit murder. 10 days later, Zeynep, Sahar, Kiti, and Mona were murdered. Why didn't we save them? The explanation that I've heard most often is this, from agencies, from organizations, from law enforcement, from politicians. We didn't understand honor-based violence. We didn't have experience with it. It wasn't on our radar. We didn't recognize the threat. These explanations, rationalizations, I think, they seem remarkable. They imply that honor violence is somehow new in Canada and it's a recent phenomenon. Really? Daljit Singh Dule explained to a psychologist that he shot to death his sister, her husband, and the couple's friend in Calgary, Alberta, because his sister had eloped with the man and had married against her family's wishes. Dule, who was 27 at the time, had been instructed by family members to sort out the shame by killing his sister and her husband. Dule told the psychologist that the dishonor to his Indian family was so great that his father was unable to go out of the house and attend to his religious duties at the temple. Dule's triple honor killing was committed in 1991, 18 years before the Shafi murders. In Langley, BC, Rajinder Singh Atwal stabbed his 17-year-old daughter Amandeep to death because he discovered that she was involved in a shameful love affair with a boy at her high school. He was convicted of second-degree murder and sent to prison. The murders were in 2003, 6 years before the Shafia case. In a parking lot in Ottawa, Ontario, Hazibullah Siddiqui shot to death his sister and her fiancé because she had dishonored their Afghan family by marrying without permission of her father. Siddiqui was sent to prison. That murder was in 2006, 3 years before the Shafia case. There are others. In my estimation, at least 12 people have died in honor killings in Canada in which convictions were registered in cases that we identified clearly as honor killings since 2000. 12 dead since 2000. Since 1990, at least 17 people dead, primarily women and girls, in cases in which convictions have been registered, Parvez, Dylan, Khari, and others. I have no doubt that there are others that were never classified as honor crimes. And despite these cases, including several that drew sustained national media attention, we're still saying in this country, as recently as the past few years, that we don't understand honor crimes, that we've never seen them before. That's hard to swallow. Coming 22 years after a horrifying triple honor killing that happened in one of our country's biggest cities, and given the fact that similar terrible crimes continue to take place regularly. Even if we don't truly comprehend the multi-layered complexity of honor crimes, surely we understand the complex dynamics of family violence, where victims are often reluctant to seek help because they are paralyzed by fear of retribution by abusers who are also economic providers, partners, and confidants. For decades, we've had detailed protocols among law enforcement and other frontline responders, including child protection agencies, to deal with reports of abuse within families. Police departments in most medium to large cities in Canada have specially trained domestic violence and domestic conflict units. They operate under very well-defined protocols for intervention and response, and typically in concert with partner community agencies. Have we done everything possible to bring this institutional knowledge and understanding to bear on honor-based violence? What have we done in response to honor-based violence? In March last year, the federal government gave a grant of roughly $350,000 to Shield of Athena in Montreal for a community outreach and public awareness campaign on honor-based violence. In April this year, the federal government gave $200,000 to the Edmonton Indo-Canadian Women's Association to do community outreach on honor-based violence. There is also some training on HBV being undertaken for frontline responders across Canada. But the value of those two grants combined is a pittance. More money was spent to renovate the courthouse in Kingston, Ontario to equip it for the Shafia trial. Millions of dollars, millions were spent on the investigation and prosecution of the Shafia murders. I have no doubt that these two agencies that I just listed that received those grants do valuable work in their communities. And like most local agencies, they probably survive on a shoestring and they desperately need the money. But we are funding programs to address a problem that we cannot quantify. As far as I can tell, no coordinated national effort is being made to collect data on the prevalence of honor-based violence in Canada. Law enforcement agencies could capture these statistics, but no one has mandated it. No one has ordered it. It is unfair and unreasonable to ask community-based agencies that operate on paltry budgets to do that work. So just how big is the problem of honor-based violence in Canada? I mentioned earlier that at least 17 people have died in identified honor killings in Canada in the past two decades in which there were convictions registered, according to my research. This is anecdotal evidence. There is no other evidence. As a journalist who covets verifiable statistics, this really frustrates me. Perhaps there are many more honor crimes that are undocumented and unreported. It's probable. We know that the true level of criminal activity is dramatically underrepresented in Canadian official police figures. The latest national victimization survey from Statistics Canada found that 7 out of every 10 violent crimes committed each year is not reported to police. 7 out of every 10 is not reported. So based on the latest data from Stats Can, that could equate to more than 800,000 violent crimes a year that are never reported to police. We could draw an extrapolation about violent honor crimes in Canada if we had some base statistics, but we don't. We don't know the scope of the problem because we haven't tried to measure it. It's possible that thousands of girls and women across Canada are right now being controlled, dominated, threatened, and abused. We need to find out. Because I'm a journalist, someone who's been writing about villains and victims for a long time, I'm also an avowed cynic. Is it possible that we don't want to accurately quantify this on the national scale? Because if we find that there's a substantial problem, it will necessitate a substantial response, not simply a few $100,000 here and there for community programs. Surely, we owe it to Zainab, Sahar, Giti, Rona, Aksa, Amandeep, Ranjita, Katera, Kowinder, and many others to at the very least make a serious attempt to quantify the scope of the problem so that we can draft a reasonable response. Thank you.